So this restaurant is part of our Downey long history. So it's been around, I'm sure you've seen it in movies, with that movie Heat. It's got a lot of activity going on. We have car shows all the time, as you're well aware. I'm a big car enthusiast myself, so this place is a special icon for me. I live two blocks away on Route 4, so I go by it all the time. But welcome to our city. Our city we're the best kept secret in LA County. We're surrounded by cities that have much higher crime than we do. We have our own police on fire. We're very proud of our independence. We're very proud of our success. But it doesn't come without a lot of hard work. And this group and this restaurant had a little hiccup years back. And the total restoration you see today is the result of a lot of hard working people. So thank you for coming here. Thank you for coming to our city. And thank you for being part of this great event. A lot of people come from all around the world, actually, to come to this Bob. There's not a lot of Bobs left. So this is a real icon for us. So thank you very much for being here. God bless you. Very much.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Jim, come on up. So this is, I'm going to introduce the guy that made this happen, right? The guy that paid for this. Jim, right? Jim, you're the guy that made this happen. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that process of... There was this outreach from the Downey, what became the Downey Conservancy around this, the Los Angeles Conservancy, the city of Downey came to you with interest. So tell us, give us a map of how we are standing here in this beautifully, look at this floor, man. Love this terrazzo floor.
Well, first, thanks a lot for coming. This is really, really touching to see so many people here from sometimes long distances to come out and see this place and remember the things that happened here. Going into this project, I was scared to death, and I was very skeptical. I had a long list of doubts that it could ever happen, and one by one, the city and people like the LA Conservancy and certainly Adrian and Annalisa really started to make me comfortable through the process to the point where we were ready to make a commitment. But it took months, and I tell you, it was Gil Levis from the city, who's now the city manager, and the mayor at the time, Mario Guerra, were both very, very helpful and really made me feel confident that we would be able to make this happen. It's been a great experience. We've been successful. We're 7 years into it now, and I feel like as a business, we really have legs under us now. That you know, we have a regular group of customers and stuff, and so it really feels good, and it really feels like all the work was worth it, and everything that we went through to get it done was beneficial. I think that. The thing that with these kind of spaces, and every city has them, I'm sure there's other ones even in Downey, they're commercial spaces and they kind of have to function as a commercial space. And that means we have to do business, you know, we're blessed with having to do business. If us or another type of building like this couldn't do business, then it would probably have to change into something else where it would work. So the reason why I'm bringing it up is I think that all of you, if you have a presence in social media or wherever you get together with your friends and stuff, to talk about these places, the places that you love, the places that you like to go to, that you like to see, places you'd like to see more of, because that's the only way they're going to be here. That's the only way they're going to get revived, is if somebody sees the financial ability to make it happen and to make that work. And that takes support, that takes customers, and it takes people to come forward and do it. One last person who's here today is Christos Miniotis. Christos is our landlord. He has been with me from the start. He has been close by. He has helped me in numerous ways. Every way he could help, he's helped. And so, you know, again, it's another piece of the puzzle that without people like Christos and certainly Adrian, who really explained the whole thing. I didn't even know anything about it. The first time I drove by here, I was looking at the location of the street. And when Gil called me and started talking about this, I said, what do you mean that blown up building? What do I want anything to do with that for? I don't know what's going on. I didn't even know the story. I knew nothing. So luckily, like I said, people like Adrian were there to explain it to me and kind of point out the significance of it and what makes it important and stuff. And then talking to a lot of people, that was the other part that really made it kind of sink into my head that, yeah, there's a big interest in it. So anyway, I just want to thank you all. I really do appreciate it. And thank you for your continued support. And we're going to have some cake and blue on, so I'm going to have to offer number. Thanks.
Something I just want to throw out on the table as Jim is throwing out things to remember. The idea of effective ownership, right, Alan? People own this place. They feel invested in this place. And I think one of the great success, one of the keys to the success of this restoration and the saving of this place was people feel invested. And they feel they own a part of it. And that's how communities save these places. So I just want to get that idea out on the table as we start this event. Alan, I'm going to introduce you. You are an architect, you are an historian. You landmarked on the National Register the Downey McDonald's at Lakewood and
Florence,
thank you, back in 1983. God bless you. The vision. The Orthodox. So, Alan, I guess you're going to get up and tell us about Googie, which is something you are a noted authority on.
Okay,
great.
Okay. Great to see all of you here, and great to be back at Bob's. I was driving up Irvine and thinking, what would have been here if it had been demolished? Well, we all can imagine very well what would have been, and it would not have been nearly as vital, interesting, exciting as this building has been since 1958, and that's because it is Googie architecture. And Googie architecture, just in a nutshell, is the architecture, the modern architecture developed here in Southern California after World War II. People moving in here, aerospace, automobiles, oil, movies, entertainment, were all kind of coalescing here and with incredible energy in Southern California, including automobiles. And everybody was using automobiles. And that automobiles made possible the multi-centered suburban city that we know. But it needed a special architecture of its own. It needed an architecture with signs. You know, you're driving down Firestone here, right at this corner, where it turns. What do you see? See that sign. Exactly. That is Googie architecture. It is not ashamed of signage, it is not ashamed of modernity, it glorifies it and it does it so well. That is because it's scaled, it's large enough, it captures the excitement of the modern era that everybody was feeling. And that's the thing about Googie architecture, it wasn't just an architecture for people who could afford beautiful homes up in Hollywood Hills that were modern, which are beautiful, you know, like the case study houses. But these Googie art buildings were for everybody. They brought the modern age to everybody so that everybody could enjoy it, participate in the modern era, and the excitement and the new technology and the television and the fancy new cars and all of this, all new materials and plastics, steel, glass, etc. And anybody could enjoy it for the price of a hamburger at Bob's Big Boy. Or, yeah, other coffee shops, which will go unnamed at this point. Simply because we are so grateful to Bob's Big Boy for helping to save this and the city of Downey. I had the opportunity a number of years ago when I was first researching Googie to interview Bob Wyant. You see him there in the second panel, right next to Burt Lancaster. And he was movie star handsome. He had this, you know, mustache. And he was known for being fair to his employees and for providing this kind of food and service to the average person and doing it so well. And I think that's an aspect of Googie architecture that we should not forget. It was meant for everybody, and it is well designed. And as I said, you can imagine what would have been here if the demolition had gone through. And it would not have been nearly as good architecture. We can say that pretty safely. It would have been dull. It would have had no identity. It would have had no connection to the people of Downey living here or Southern California in general. Yeah, that's what Googie architecture is. Whether it's the theme building at LAX by William Ferreira, Charles Luckman, or if it's the gas station in Beverly Hills with the triangular upswept roof, or if it's any number of coffee shop or car wash or gas stations around Southern California. It defines Southern California. And I just, finally, I was rereading Tom Wolfe's article on this.
The hair boy.
It's an article he wrote, I think for Esquire maybe.
I'm gonna hold on, we're gonna do this together.
Yeah. Oh, okay, you know.
This is about 1964 to 1965.
He comes out to Southern California. He has a PhD from Yale, for heaven's sakes. But he comes out to Southern California and he gets these vibes that something is going on here in terms of design and style and fashion. And one of the person he meets is George Barris also, but Ed Roth, who had his studio down the way here. And apparently Wolf shows up in his seersucker suit
and
a tie.
No. We're gonna set this up properly. You almost have it.
Okay.
We're gonna set this up, and I'm gonna give this to you on a platter. You're gonna love this. I'm sorry for interrupting you. This is good. Okay. So this place, this was one of the centers of cruising culture. So South Los Angeles was the epicenter of hot rods. You have four used parts down where the old Goodyear factory was. You have Bell Auto Parts on Gage with the cylinder heads and the chrome molybdenum. You have these incredibly important places. You have Ed Roth's studio in Maywood, down the street from Canning Hardware in Maywood. You have all these places that create this engine of culture in Southern California, and this is one of the places where everyone showed off. This is one of the places where everyone came in their hot rods with their clothes. So Tom Wolfe comes to South Los Angeles, comes to Maywood, comes to Downey several times. He starts with an earlier essay in 63 on Ed Big Daddy Roth about big car makers.
Yeah.
And he falls in love with Roth and what's happening here. He comes back for the hair boys to Harvey's in 1966 for that essay. So, Alan, let's just bring this all together. You have Ed Big Daddy Roth, a man who invents the fiberglass car, right? He makes these cars that no one else has imagined before. He pushes it down a back alley, half a block, to Canning Hardware, where the Triton Car Club engine builders, some of the greatest engine builders the world has ever seen, Keith Black, Fritz Voigt, they put in these custom engines that are built with machines taken out of plants from the 1930s, which has been repurposed post-World War II by retired engineers who want to make better, faster, hotter cars.
Why? Because it's Southern California and we love cars.
Exactly. And Ed Roth changes the world, how we see everything. Tom Wolfe writes an essay about that right here. So, Alan, in 1968, Tom Wolfe is talking about this as the Dior of the working man. Okay, so I want you to bring in the architect William Ferreira and the quest for regional modernism with affordable materials. I want you to bring in Tom Wolfe and his sartorial splendor. of being forced by Ed Big Daddy Roth to take off his seersucker suit in Roth's studio, at Roth's garage, and put on a t-shirt.
And just to come here.
Roth said, you cannot wear a seersucker suit, they'll kill us. They'll kill us and they'll burn my car. So fashion, architecture, cars, design. Go.
Well, this is what Southern California modernism is all about. And again, it's for the average person at places like this. And it's the clothes that they can wear. And it's the places that they inhabit. And it doesn't always get its due attention or respect, I don't think. But here at Harvey's, Bob's, which is the real, it's the Parthenon of this sort of style, we can really appreciate it. We need to stand up and realize exactly how important it is. It is an aesthetic, it is a style, it is a modern concept which was embodied in these buildings. And whether it was these coffee shops or if it was the work of William Pereira, I'm putting a plug for you. For example, LA County Museum by William Pereira opens in 1965. You know, we're in the same time period here. And it was Pereira's idea of how to take modernism beyond the Bauhaus to infuse in it a Southern California sensibility. This populism that I've talked about, but also a sense of how buildings look in the sunlight and how they can be sculptured as well as functional, and also how they look at night as well with these great signs. Those signs were all, you know, very carefully designed. So we have an entire modern sensibility of architecture which takes takes modernism beyond the international style, puts a Southern California stamp on it, the stamp of the lifestyle of the average person here and of the architects who work here, and a sense of the vision of the future of how things can be better and we can look, you know, this way instead of that way. And all of these things are just incredibly intertwined. And I just have to say one thing about how alive this culture still is. Because we have the Hair Boys by Tom Wolfe, which is mid-1960s, and he does say how Harvey's here actually is the Dior or the Balenciaga or one of these. It is the center of fashion. Not in Paris, but here in Southern California. And all of these new styles of clothing for men and women. And so that's a historical document. We know that that is what Harvey's was in 1965. After this was miraculously restored through the help of Jim Lauder and Adrian and the city of Downey and so many other people who I really admire and respect for the work and the effort they put into saving this important piece of architecture. After it opened, when did it reopen? 2009. I came here, inviting some friends from LA to come down. And I'm sitting in the booth and way in the back there. And coming in the back door was this young man who had the most amazing combination of bouffant and mohawk. And his clothes were, you know, quite right along with the style. It struck me, you know, deaf and blind for a moment. 1958, this was a center of fashion. 2009, it was a center for fashion that we still need to pay attention to. And that's why it's so great that it's here and that you're all here to celebrate what a wonderful thing it is. That's all I have to say, Richard.
You did it, man. Thank you. Chris Nichols here? Is Chris Nichols here yet? No, not gonna make it.
Who else is gonna talk? Would you like us to narrate this?
Yeah, why don't, yes, let's do, okay. So, we're gonna, great. So we have a slideshow about this. Yeah, all right, go. Good job.
Sanders. I was part of the Friends of Johnie's coalition in the community of Downey. As Ellen has so eloquently said, I wasn't schooled in Googie architecture growing up in the community, but I did know when I was 16 years old and I was late for my curfew that this was a beacon that I was close to home and I was, you know, not going to be in much trouble. And I became versed in it through Adrian Bianco, who at the time was heading the Los Angeles Conservancy's Modern Committee. And back in 2002, we forged forces, and I said, we've got a group of people here that were angry, we wanted to preserve it, we valued it for everything that was communicated earlier, and we turned to Adrian and said, let's do something.
It actually closed very quietly on New Year's Eve at midnight, and the original owner, she bought it for the first time. They say that since 1950 all the way up until 2001, it was never locked because it was open 24 hours for everyone. And I think that that's what actually helped it to become home. So it's a little bit of Downey drink in Europe. And this is just an old name of Downey during my reports. This is Harvey and Minnie Ortner. They were Oklahomans.
And Minnie, she came on board early on when the Friends of Johnie was forming, and it was such a delight. She's since passed, but she made amazing contributions to us along the way. We're forever grateful to her.
So it was Minnie who locked the door for a person last time. And Harvey and Minnie Ortner came here from Oklahoma, and they purchased this site here on Firestone and Old River School Road when it was still a poultry farm. And so when you think about this place emerging from a poultry farm, chickens and turkeys, you can imagine how people were stunned when it opened in 1958. And Harvey Ortner worked for General Motors. This is from the original architectural drawings by architect Paul Beer, and we'll be there from his granddaughter in a little while. The original plans. And when the building was rebuilt after the demolition, these were the plans that luckily our friend and photographer Larry Underhill had scanned for. I don't know what the original prints are. We hope that great granddaughter will tell us where it's called from our time. But that would be nice. Thank goodness you have this scan. The original plan showed a fountain in this area out here. That was never. This is the famous photo, the oldest photo really of Harvey's brother from 1958 that you will see on the wall. And this is Harvey Ortner with the chef at the time. These were publicity photos that Minnie Ortner shared with us. This is when Harvey's got a van to deliver burgers to. An early car hop photo. The original walkway. Some of the items on this auditorium were taken from the Ortner's Broiler because they owned a number of Broilers in Linwood and Pagina and other places. And their famous burger was the Harvey's Chevrolet. This is really during its heyday, during the Christian heyday. spectacular automotive exposition in the world with $1 million worth of cars. The finest cars in Southern California. And
yeah, it's not a picture. I know it's dark, but if you look, you can see that the cars are literally piled out over the school road, just jamming their way in. And Helen lived that experience.
And these are apparently real numbers right here. Harvey's bores an almost unbelievable 5,000 cars each weekend. That's an astonishing figure for the early 60s. There was even a girl that stole a car before she was able to drive, so she could come here. Her parents said, "We're not going to get you in trouble unless we understand." This is during it's Johnny's era, which is in the late 60s. This fat boy is what this mascot was known as. He's at the other parking lot.
Adrian, is your relation to the Johnnies on Western Perfect?
There was a relationship.
The same Johnnies, the same chain?
It was thought to be a cousin.
Right.
We have a guest here from Utah who can tell you about this. Burley, Burlisle.
Burley, you are wanted.
You are wanted.
So back in 2002, when we first were trying to have a coalition and get resources to sell the significance of the building, we met Burley Burlisle.
Hello.
Who was part of the cruise culture back in the day, and he gave to Adrian and I this wonderful box of treasure troves about Harvey's. He gave us video, letters of the significance of this place, and all kinds of people, and we'd like to say some words about this experience and the cruise that you are on.
I was fortunate late 70s to come and interview Harvey for an article I wrote for Streetwater magazine about Harvey's, because it was such a special place to make for him. And I'm here with my buddy Tom over here, who we cruised together back. And through that, I learned a lot more about the history of Harvey's, the background, how he could afford to let us sit out there and just break the toilet. All you're of my age, so I know you could sit out there looking for girls, whatever you can do. But he said that the cost of the Cokes was so cheap he could afford to let us sit there all night long as we could buy one or two. He was happy with that. From that, a gentleman named Rusker Bale, who belonged to the Orange County Cruising Association, in 1983, put together a cruise in here. And this is the video that Annalise are talking about. And they brought in a regular video crew to video this thing. The Street Rodder magazine and the Rod Action magazine invited people to come here. It was a two-day event, and it was packed. In fact, we talked about the history of Ed Roth, his connection with this. He came and videoed it. Going back to the Orange County Cruising Association, had this one set up. And because I had some history, they stuck the microphone in my hand. I didn't know this was going to happen, but I got to stand out here where the cruisers were for an hour and a half and interview each car as they came through and talk to them. And they shared their stories of coming through with their parking lights on or getting a ticket for not having a license plate light when they pulled out of the parking lot. And this was documented. It's a really neat VHS tape at that point, if anybody's ever put it on a CD. And I had a copy of that, which I was able to share with the girls and Kevin. And, you know, these girls took it along with Jim and Bob and everybody else and brought this place back together. I live up in Utah now. I haven't come to Southern California without coming. Anyway.
were on board with us from day one. There every week, every meeting.
We didn't know what we were doing, but we were for it.
Exactly, we didn't know what we were doing. And Helen was here the day Harvey's Broiler opened.
Yeah.
And she was the sole individual who saw the demolition occurring on that afternoon. I'll let Helen explain the story.
A friend of mine had a feral cat. She wanted me to trap it so we could take it in and get it fixed. And she happened to live off of a little school road. So I came up this way, and I happened to look over, and I saw all the cars were gone, because before all the cars were there. All the cars were gone, and I kind of looked, and I saw like a bulldozer type thing coming in and tearing down the back. And I go, uh-oh, this is not right, because we knew they were not supposed to do this. I mean, not that it was never going to happen, but it was not something that was supposed to happen now. So I went over to where I was going to trap the cats, and I called my husband, I called the police, I called them and told them, hey, somebody's tearing down the broiler. And they said, well, what are we supposed to do about it? And I said, well, you better call somebody to find out, because they should not be doing this. I'm sure they don't have a permit. It's Sunday. Who does this on a Sunday? They do it on Saturday, finish it up on Sunday, but they don't start. So he said, well, I'll do the best I can. And in the meantime, I had my husband call Annalisa, and she called. Well, I said, just call everybody you can. And everybody called everybody, started calling the police and telling them they can't be doing this. So by the time I got the cat, which took me a little while, got the cat, took it back home, and came back here. I mean, the news crew was here, everybody who had ever been here was here. It was, everybody was very heartbroken. I mean, even though it was a used car lot in here, it still holds this thing, you know, of your childhood, or not your child, but your teens at least. And it was heartbreaking to see what happened. So, I was so glad that we all got the support of the community here and everywhere. People came from everywhere to see what had happened. In the end, it kind of got knocked down anyhow, which, you know, who knows, maybe it had to be that way. Obviously it had to be that way. But I took, the next day, I took two stones that were laying out in the parking lot home with me, and I put them in my garden. You know, that's like, okay, that's that stone from there, and I'm going to keep it because it means something to me. So after Jim bought it and everything, one day I came over to him and I said, Jim, I have two stones. He said, can I get them back? He said, yes, I can get them back. So he's got them over there by the, where the chip box used to be over there. He said, these are your stones. They're right here. Right here. But, yeah, I didn't want to give them up. I wanted something to remember, because this meant so much to me. And, well, to a lot of teenagers. I mean, you know, they were yelling at us, stay in your car. Don't get out of your car. Don't walk around. Blah, blah, blah. You know. But it was just fun. It was just innocent and wonderful time.
And you were here.
Yes, when it opened, yes. Yeah, because I was going back and forth to school. I finished my high school year at Southgate, but we had moved to Downey, but I got permission to go back. So I was going by here every single day. I saw everything was going on. When it was ready to open, I grabbed my girlfriends and said, we're going, you know. So here we were. Like I say, in spite of a lot of people's teenage years, which are, I think, the best years of our lives, at least until you get married now, man. Now, I'm not a hero because they did tear it down, but the point is, it made such an impression on so many people that they could not rebuild. Right. We just had to find somebody who was willing to do it, which was Jim to do it.
I think putting on the preservation hat for a minute on this topic, what's really important is that Lisa, and every other person that worked on the project, from the Conservancy, Friends of Johnie's, all were ready for something to happen in the building. They had a car out that had chipped away at the demo the kitchen, and they jackhammered out a big portion of the project. I remember too, the Friends of Johnie's had a meeting that, you know, watching for it to quantify it, like the San Pacific or some other disaster to be called.
excited the whole structure. They were getting closer. They had not done near what they did when I came by the time I came back. That guy was ripping into her. Yeah.
And that was the tent that was here. And it was an illegal demolition where they did not pull the original permits because they were denied demolition permit the previous these are really like the next morning after the demolition. So this is January 8th, 2007. So when people say, but was the damage that bad? Remember these photos. The damage was very extensive and it was everywhere. When I saw it, when the news crews came up, I said it looked like a bomb. But that's what I saw. This is the
Adrian, I think Chris Nichols is here.
Chris,
come on up and say something.
Okay.
Hi, Chris.
This is the moment. All right, it's the moment. Hi, I'm late, but I wanted to join Adrian here on this occasion to mark the 10th anniversary of the horror and carnage that you saw on the screen there. I'm Chris Nichols. I'm the former chair of the LA Conservancy Moderate Committee. I write a column in Los Angeles Magazine. I love old buildings. And I love this place. And you know, 20 years ago, when it was a real rundown rat trap of Johnny's Broiler, we all loved it. 50, 60 years ago, when it was a gleaming Harvey's Broiler, I'm sure some of you loved it. And then Adrian Biondo, who is an incredible force of nature. Those of you that don't know Adrian. Former chair of the LA Conservancy Moderate Committee, Adrian heard about this demolition happening late at night, raced down here with all you Friends of Johnie's, all you Downeyites, all you people that love this place, and at least everybody loves this place so much, to see your wonderful friend, your old friend, your icon, this great thing in this town being destroyed. And it was so wrenching and awful. I got this call, they had a candlelight vigil. We all raced down here to be with our friend and to love these beans and to keep it going. Maybe that's the end of the story in some cases. And in many cases, preservation is over when the bulldozers arrive. But not with Adrian Biondo, who willed this building back to life. But also through her incredible ability to bring together this group, including people in the city, including all sorts of obscure financial machinations that made it possible to become job training and parkland and really interesting and unusual ways of dealing with preservation, dealing with the things that we always have to deal with, which is lack of money, lack of interest, lack of an operator, lack of a building. And it all came together in this wonderful reimagining of Harvey's Broiler as Bob's Big Boy Broiler. And we are all so grateful that Adrian saw something besides a giant pile of rubble, which is what the rest of us saw, and imagined it back again. And look at this group that we put together here, all these folks. Adrian's Friends of Johnie's group, Bicycle Bobby there. Is Bicycle Bobby still around here? All these wonderful folks that came together locally, regionally, and just all over to bring this back to life. Dear old Minnie Ortner, Minnie and Harvey, who's part of the place, was part of the group. And it was just a wonderful thing to be a small part of. And I'm so grateful to Adrian. I was involved in the McDonald's issue back in the early 90s. here in Downey. I dressed up like Speedy. I marched on the corner. I did all I could to try to help bring that back. But any of my efforts in, I think, in 30 years of doing this were eclipsed by the complete rebuilding of a destroyed place. And so, and her ghost crews and all the things she did, what an amazing lady. I'm so in awe of Adrienne Biondo and the work that she's done here. Thank you, Adrienne. Came in, if he's here, I don't know if Jim's here right now, but Jim Louder, who came in and decided that this would be a great home for a Bob's Big Boy, the vision to come in and see such horror and imagine such beauty from it. So thank you to Jim Louder and Bob's Big Boy for bringing this back to life. And all of you car clubs, architectural preservationists, historians, Big Boy fanatics, hamburger lovers, and just people that want to be in a special place for keeping it going, keeping it alive years later. And hopefully we'll be back here for more anniversaries in the future, and this place will just keep on shining. So enjoy your Big Boy hamburger, read my column in Los Angeles Magazine, support Adrienne Biondo and the other Conservancy and all the groups that she's involved with, and thank you very much for listening. Thank you, Richard, again for keeping the history of these places in the public eye as well as you do.
Perfect. Stay right there. Okay. Adrienne, Chris, we're going to play a game. We're going to throw out some major milestones in bringing this place back to opening. Okay? Just very quickly. So, I'll get over here. So, before this place is in peril, while it's still a restaurant, Friends of Johnie's puts together the California Register application to get this on the California Register, which is rejected because the owner has to sign the application, which he won't do.
But nevertheless, qualifies the building.
The building is qualified. A side effect of this application is the blueprints are digitized, correct? Yes, yes. So the blueprints for this place exist. They're digital form. So when the building is demolished, you can go to prospective leasers and say, oh, it's really sad the place has been demolished, but here are the blueprints, right? This is a very good thing to show Jim Louder, right? That you have the blueprints, okay? That's good. That's very important. Good.
I think it's instrumental.
Other really important milestones on the way from demolition to rebuilding, Rubies. So it's a pile of rubble. The city of Downey has expressed a commitment to try and find someone who will take a lease and rebuild it. And they're on board, that's good. You get a letter from the CEO of Rubies. Go ahead.
That's a really cute story.
Yeah, and it's really important because it maps to what happened with Taco Bell down the street. Because down the street, the original Taco Bell had to be moved. And so people like our friend Katie Robosely were tasked with the task of finding a corporate fast food corporation who would express interest in wanting to save the structure. So what happened with the letter of interest from Rubies?
The letter of interest from Rubies.
Stand up.
Actually, a really important moment in our fight because Annalisa and I, we were running out of options to keep the city engaged enough to continue the moratorium that we had put on the site to prevent any building permits from being pulled or the site from being scraped. So, without having interest from a prospective operator, Kevin Preciado, who joined us with the coalition and helped us form the coalition to rebuild the boiler. He contacted Bob's, he contacted many other operators. Annalisa and I contacted Rubies, and Rubies was unresponsive because I asked directly to talk to the CEO. So I kept calling every day. I called the secretary, answered the phone, and she was very friendly. And finally, we said, do we have any dollars in our little kitty to send a bouquet of flowers? So we sent a bouquet of flowers, and then the next day we got a call from the CEO. And that was after many months of trying to engage with them. And it was very clear. He came here, he looked at it, he said, not for me. He because his style of rubies, you know, is very deco with lots of curving lines, and this is a little later architectural style for him. And I said, could you write a letter of interest? And that would help us. So we brought that LOI to City Council. Very nice. They were talking about pulling the moratorium off of the building. And there was some upset about not marking up the sign and so on. But that letter, I read the letter to the record of that on the sign. And if it wasn't for that, this actually might not be here because that was a very good thing.
Good. Perfect. Love it.
Go on.
Is Brooklyn here?
Madison?
Yeah, he's right here.
Oh, hey!
Oh,
hey!
Are you Madison?
Yeah.
So do you guys want to talk about your grandpa for a second? Come on up. Okay. Come on. Great building.
I'm really nervous.
That's okay. Turn around, introduce yourself.
Hi.
Adrian, hold her hand. There you stand.
My name's Madison. I'm Paul Clayton's great-granddaughter. He was the original architect for this place. I kind of remember him. I had a really good relationship with him when I was little, and he was like my favorite of the whole entire family. And he would have been 103 this year. He died when he was 91. He was born in Salt Lake City, but grew up here in Downey, raised his family here in Downey. He actually was the architect for many houses in Downey neighborhoods. He designed his own house that he raised his children in. And he actually was designing for a really long time and didn't actually get his architectural license until he was 70 years old. He's designed over like 300 places, but you won't find his name very often because he didn't have the actual license until he was up there. So he did design Harvey's Broiler, and this was his favorite place. And he loved cars. He never saw him driving anything but a Cadillac. He was very tall, and he wore a cowboy hat all the time. And so I don't know too much, but I just know that he's very important.
You're perfect.
Yeah, he's very important, very creative, and you know, a legend in my eyes. So thank you.
Okay, so thank you. That was fantastic.
Did
thank
you drive your classic car here today?
Yeah, what classic car did you drive today?
We brought a 56 T-Bird.
All right.
Yeah.
I like it. Adrian, come on, stand up next to me. Let's get through. So we're gonna finish off the milestones that bring this to reopening. So a very important milestone, the Community Redevelopment Agency of Downey. As you find a couple interested parties, Jim is one of them, of course, and the City of Downey CRA says, okay, we're going to put in a
$900,000 in the end we were able to
okay, so
get
the
CRA.
They pledged $900,000 to this project, which is a non-trivial sum of money. And so that I think that's a that's one of the great kicks this project has. Okay, so we're almost there. You've got a couple people interested. Jim has some Bob Big Boys in Torrance. You want to go see him in his Bob Big Boy in Torrance?
We visited Jim and we brought the laptop and we ran footage of all the movies that were shot here at Johnny's. Here's a very busy operator of Bob's Big Boy, and he keeps coming back to our table, but they now live a lot for us. And it was Kevin Preciado and I kept running more and more footage. It's like, you guys are helping out getting me to come out of this. But we were intrigued with him and he owned a Bob's Big Boy, so it only seemed right that that would be the next logical step.
Okay, and then what was the last stone in the arch that when it went in, that was it. It was freestanding. It was gonna get to yes. What was the last big?
The 99-year lease that Chris was the owner was here.
Okay.
So that, I mean, every restaurant operator would like to have a 99-year lease.
So the CRA, the 99-year lease, with that, you're downhill.
And we promised that all of the
everyone that eaten here before would come back. I think that was a fair commitment on your part. For half a million people. Yeah.
Richard?
Did we do it?
Richard?
Yeah.
Come here. Is there Charles Phoenix did something.
Okay. Oh, is Charles Phoenix here?
He is. Yeah.
Where's Charles? How are the bus tours?
How are you?
What? It's good to see you. How are the bus tours?
Good.
All right, Charles Phoenix, I don't know.
Hi, everybody.
I don't know.
Hi, Charles.
Do you want to just say something?
Is there an imaginary microphone here?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
A most gracious good afternoon, everybody. Great to be here at Bob's Big Boy, Broiler, in Downey. I do think that it's proof that miracles do happen, preservation can happen. We have a hero here, that really, Adrian, hello Adrian. It is possible.
I could not have done anything without
Annalisa. And Annalisa.
Truly. Annalisa was like on the ground right here in Downey. Available 24 hours a day.
Annalisa, I've just been told Annalisa was on the ground here in Downey 24 hours a day. And now she lives here.
And our motto, honest to God, was we wake up, we save Johnny's.
We wake up, we save Johnny's. Yes! I do want to say a couple of things, you guys, before we go, or before whatever. Let's not turn our backs on Johnny out in the parking lot there, Bob's cousin, who faded a little to green. He's back there, right, Nichols? Back there. Now, Jim, the owner here, told me, hi, Jim, did you tell me that the Bob's, the big boy spinning up there, right up there, spent 20 years in a strip club in Detroit? You told me that, right? So just so you know. Otherwise, thank you, Jim, for hosting us here. Richard, thank you. And it's great to be here. Now, everybody, let's have a big boy.
Yeah. Okay, we just have a couple. Charles, thank you so much. And just very quickly, Adrian, you wanted to call some people up. Let's go.
I see key figures out there, so I wanted to ask if George Red Fox would like to say a
word. Yeah, where's George?
George? Katie.
George
Red Fox? Katie.
Katie, come on up. Katie, come on. Yeah, you.
Jay Platt, who was here in the morning of Jay Demolition.
Come on. I haven't seen Jay in like 10 years.
That's great.
Hey man, it's good to see you.
Come on, sir.
I see you. Hey,
come on up. Good to see you, man. Come on, stand here.
So I'm Jay Platt, and I used to work for the LA Conservancy. And I got the call Monday morning that something horrible had happened. And so the LA Conservancy had to get involved, and I was the guy who came down. And, you know, it was just, as you've seen and as you know, tragic situation. And that was when is the former mayor here?
No, we haven't seen him.
Okay. No, Maria Garrow. Yeah. So he was the person I met who was from Downey. So it was good to connect politically right away, because I think he became kind of one of the key figures who turned this into kind of a political situation. And as you guys know, preservation and politics are deeply intertwined, and if you don't have the political support, it's hard to make something like this happen. So my role was incredibly tiny compared to Adrian and Jim and everyone else who was involved here, but it was really important for the LA Conservancy, after all of the work that was done through Chris and the Modern Committee, to kind of show that we're still here in Downey, we're still supporting things around the county, not just focused in LA like a lot of people always think the Conservancy is. And so just dealing with getting the code enforcement people going and the kind of political and legal aspect, the machine kind of moving, was a really a key part of making this happen. So between the passion of Annalisa and Adrian and the neighbors and the political people and us kind of pushing a little on our end, I'm very proud to be involved at my little level here, and it's thrilling to see this celebration that you guys have arranged. So.
So Katie, I was actually hoping you could talk to us about some preservation you've been doing just down the street, because it is very relevant to what has happened here and what we're all doing.
Well, unfortunately, it's not really down the street anymore. but for those of you who don't know, my name is Katie, and I'm the executive director of a nonprofit called We Are the Next, and we have been working with Taco Bell to save the world's first Taco Bell. Which was originally just right over here on Firestone, and about 18 years ago, was it a year ago?
It was a year ago.
Oh my gosh, time doesn't fly that fast. So a year ago, I was working with George, and we got wind from the property owners that they either needed to demolish the building or get it out of there because they had to plant the property that the Taco Bell was on. And George and his amazing advocacy got Taco Bell involved, moved down to Conservancy, and then they secondhand found me. And our organization has been working with them to save and completely restore the exterior of the first Taco Bell, which we moved last November. So we moved about a year ago. It's in Irvine right now, which is keeping it safe from demolition while we find a permanent home, and we're going to be fixing the building for a couple of years in the near future. So stay tuned. Keep tabs on We Are Next.
Fantastic. George, come on. Okay, this is George Red Fox. George, you're the man. Tell us your favorite thing about standing here, and tell us your worst moment between 2007 and now.
Can I give the little intro?
Yeah.
Annalisa and friends of mine have worked very, very hard. We have just, you know, when you're like down there, just working with them. And then we see this handsome gentleman come down the aisle and present 10,000 signatures to the
committee. So my name's George. I'm actually a teacher at Warren High School, and the way it kind of came around is the weekend before the demolition, one of my students had asked me, she's like, "Hey, Mr. Red Fox, why are all the cars pulled off the lot over there at the Broiler?" And I'm like, "I don't know." So I called the city and I said, "Hey, is there any demolition plans or anything?" And they're like, "No, there's no demolition plans for that building." But lo and behold, that weekend, on a Sunday afternoon, the bulldozers started taking the place apart. I think you called me actually that afternoon in the evening, right? And they couldn't get it stopped. They wanted to get it stopped. I called. I happen to have one of the council members' numbers on my phone, Cartosian. And I called him up and I said, "Hey, they're illegally demolishing Johnny's Broiler right now." And he goes, "They're doing what?" And I'm like, "They're demolishing the building right now." He goes, "Are there plans for demolition?" And I said, "No, I just checked on Friday. There's no plan." So he's the one who called the cops, and then they kind of stopped the whole demolition after that. So lo and behold, time went by. I had a bunch of signatures. We had people gathering signatures, student signatures, people around the community. I don't know how many exactly we had. It was a lot, though. It was a ton of signatures. And then I had a lot of students show up, too. A lot of students wanted to council members, standing room only, which was kind of cool. So that's kind of my story.
What was your job like? Your worst moment?
You know, just not knowing that if it was going to be rebuilt or not, because I had always seen it as a kid driving through Downey. I had always seen the Broiler and always loved it. Just not knowing if it would come back. I guess that's probably the darkest moment.
The darkest moment was after the city had agreed to put a moratorium on building anything on the site. And they agreed to do it for a year. So the entire year of 2007, when they told us that, well, didn't have an operator. To me, that was the hardest one because we were pretty much brought out. We had to cruise the process. We made many documents. We did everything that we possibly could. That definitely is the hardest one.
All right, well, thank you, Jim.
Thank you, Jim.
Reminder server, see everyone on Saturday night. That's a joke.